Hello everyone, this is a great pleasure to welcome you today to the talk of Professor Gabriel Perret. So Gabriel is a professor at École Normale Supérieure and research director at CNRS in Paris. He finished his PhD some time ago, I think in 2005, from Paris. And he's an expert in optimal transport, but also has a very in-depth knowledge of machine learning and computer vision, computer graphics, and a number of topics related to them. So I would like to underline that this talk is streamed online on YouTube, and also that it's this invitation is co-sponsored by IDIAB and by the Swiss Mathematical Society. So thank you very much, Gabriel, for coming, and I'm leaving the floor to you.
Okay, thanks a lot. It's a great pleasure to be here. So what I will do today is kind of a general introduction to this field of optimal transport and illustrate with few applications, mainly in machine learning. So interrupt me if there's something that is not clear. My goal is to convey a bit of the idea from the algorithmic side and to try to see how it interacts, of course, with optimization and mathematics. So this is a joint work with a lot of colleagues, most importantly Marco Cuturi, who is my close collaborator on this idea of approximate optimal transport. And many of the results are actually those of the PhD thesis of Aude, especially when I will speak about the sample complexity in high dimension. Okay, before starting, a bit of advertisement for this book that I wrote with Marco, that you can find online. So everything that I will say today, you can find it in this book with much more details, of course. It also includes some codes and links and references, so feel free to go. There's also slides for courses and so on. So feel free to go to have more information. So before starting, why should we care about probability distribution, point cloud, empirical measure? I guess it's because in many applications, it's quite natural to frame the problem using this language of distribution. These are just a few examples. I think the easiest one are in low dimension for imaging sciences. If you think about the color palette of image, this is just each pixel is a point, so it's like the empirical distribution of the color. And if you want to modify the color palette, change it, it's going to be the problem of comparison, modification of distribution. Same line of ideas for distribution of mass, for instance, of activity in the brain for neuroscience. For shape matching, shape registration, it's also very natural to model the shape as a distribution of mass, a distribution of feature. You could also think about the distribution of curvature, of normals. So it's quite natural to view this distribution of feature using the language of density. And this is more high-dimensional problems. This could be in natural language processing, where you want to model a corpus of documents, and each document will be modeled using a distribution of something. And the simple idea is just the distribution of the set of words contained in each document. So here the size of the letter is proportional to the number of times the word appears in the text. So it's very simple, and of course you can think about more complex distribution, but then you would compare the document by comparing this bag of features, this bag of words. This would be for instance, for clustering or for supervised learning. And the same line of ideas is in unsupervised learning, for instance, for modeling images. So here the goal is to understand in some way the distribution of all the images, for instance, on the internet, in order to draw some new image or to solve some problems with it. And you'd like to model this very, very high dimensional distribution of points, of images. It's very large space. So here, once again, the natural language for unsupervised learning is the language of distribution. Okay, so just to be a bit more precise, what you would typically have to solve as a problem for instance, unsupervised learning, is you are given a distribution of points, observation, and you want to model it using some kind of a density, and in a parametric settings, it would be parametrized by theta here. And you want to find the best theta so that this red density match as closely as possible the input. Okay? This would be like a classical problem of parameter estimation. Typically, in a very simple setup, you can choose a Gaussian, and then theta would be the mean and the variance. But of course, in order to model more complicated data sets, you want to introduce more parameters, more complex models. Typically, deep learning models are used for this task. And now it becomes non-trivial and actually very difficult to find the best theta to model the distribution. Okay? And of course, what is behind this is the loss function you'd like to use to make the fit. The question is, how do you compare this red distribution to this blue distribution using some discrepancy? Okay? This is basically the core of my talk, is what kind of discrepancy you would like. And the idea here in all the talk is to make use of some underlying geometry. So you'd like to use some discrepancy here, D, that is really geometrical, that is able to make these guys together as close as possible by exploiting some knowledge about where your data lives. Could be, for instance, if you think about color, using just the Euclidean distance between the color. Of course, you could use more perceptual distance, but start by Euclidean. On the shape, you could use the geodesic distance, maybe, or something like this. On the space of words, of course, this is very hard. This is like a linguistic question of what is the distance between words. So, a lot of people working on this, but you could find, for instance, some kind of Euclidean embedding for the word. So, it makes sense to use some kind of a distance between the words. And the same thing for image, it's very, very complicated. What is the natural distance between image? It's certainly not an Euclidean space, the space of image. And it's really the underlying idea between all this revolution of deep learning, is they try to find good ways to model images. So in all this field, there are actually a very natural ground distance between the points. And the goal of this theory of optimal transport is to lift this distance between pairs of points to a distance between group of points or between distributions. Okay, so really I want to convey this idea that optimal transport is really a tool, an automatic tool, to lift a distance between points that you typically have in your application to a more complicated distance between a set of points or distribution. Okay, so it's a main take-home message. Okay? So I will give you, I would say, the historical theory of optimal transport that was revolutionized in the 40s by Leonid Kantorovich, who was a Russian mathematician. So I will explain what his construction is. And then I will speak to what we do currently, which is an approximate optimal transport, which is somehow related to the work of Schrödinger. And I will explain why it's important in high dimension, because the second take-home message is in high dimension, optimal transport doesn't work. So you need to approximate it in order to have something that works in practice for high-dimensional learning problems. All right, so what is the problem of optimal transport in the language of Kantorovich? The goal is to compare two distributions. So I will mostly focus on discrete distribution, but everything that I say works for arbitrary, continuous density, whatever. So in this discrete language, what is a distribution? It's just a set of points with weights on each point. Okay? So the xi, they are the position of the point, so like a Dirac mass. And the ai is just the weight, the mass at each point. So the ai are positive number, and they sum to one because for most of what I will say, we will focus on a probability density. Okay? And you'd like to compare these two groups of points together. Okay? And the revolution of Kantorovich, and he got the Nobel Prize in economy for this, is to describe this notion of transportation between these clouds using what he calls a coupling between the points. So what is a coupling? It's kind of a non-deterministic transport. Okay? It's an array of numbers. Okay? So if you have n elements in A and m in B, it's going to be a matrix of size n times n. It's positive element. And each time you have a non-zero element in this matrix, it means you want to transfer some mass from here to here. So for instance, on the first row, you see there is a single non-zero element. It means that all the mass of A, of this point, the first point, gets transferred to this point. So this would correspond to a deterministic transport between this point toward this point. What historically was introduced by Monge more than 200 years ago. But Kantorovich says sometimes you can split the mass. So if you look at the second row, you see that there is two non-zero elements. It means that this second mass of A gets split into two parts. Okay, so the mass gets split, and it gets back to this end. It's like a non-deterministic transfer where some element of mass can be split in two parts. Okay? So this introduces a set of possible coupling between A and B. What are they? They are the set of matrices that are positive and that obey the conservation of mass. What does it mean? It means all the mass of A gets transferred to all the mass of B. It means that the sum along each row of P must be equal to A, and the sum along each column must be equal to B. This is simply conservation of mass during the transport. Okay, in terms of matrix vector notation, it means that the matrix P times 1, which will compute the sum along the row, should be equal to A. And the transpose of P times 1 should be equal to B. These are the two conservation of mass constraints. Okay, and why is it really like a breakthrough? It's because this set is very simple. It's just linear positivity constraints and affine constraints. So this guy is a big convex set, it's a big polyhedra. And convexity will play a key role in order to be able first to have algorithm and also to study the theory. So the fact that you can split the mass, this introduction by Kantorovich of this possibility to split the mass, make transport a convex problem, as opposed to wanting to link in a deterministic way pairs of points. Okay. So now you have the notion of what is a transport, then what would be the optimal transport? It would be the best possible coupling that minimizes some functional. So you have to say what is the price you pay when you transfer a unit of mass from point xi to yj. It can be any number, but usually what people would say is, you give me some notion of distance between pair of points, and I will pay a price which is proportional to the distance to a power p, where p is some integer that is typically larger than 1. Okay? So historically, in the work of Monge, he used p equal 1, which is actually very hard to study mathematically. Mathematicians often use p equal 2 because it's much simpler. But from an application perspective, you can use any p you want. Usually you prefer smaller p to avoid giving too much influence to outliers, but it's just your choice. So Kantorovich will pick the best possible p, and why is it very nice? It's because this is just a linear function, and this is a convex polyhedral constraint. So this is the first, one of the first appearance of linear programming. Okay, and actually, Kantorovich got the Nobel Prize for this, but you could say that George Danzig, who worked at very similar time, should also got the Nobel Prize, because George Danzig is the one that created the simplex algorithm. So George Danzig is the one that explained how you can solve this actually in practice. And in fact, simplex algorithms are very efficient for optimal transport. So it's really the combination of the genius of Kantorovich, who proposed a convex formulation for the transport problem, and Danzig's new algorithm that were able to make this breakthrough, first in economic, because this was mostly used initially to model economics problems, where you have demand and factories that create objects, so you want to match factories to the demand. But of course, it's much more general, and today we are using it more for, I would explain, machine learning or data science problems. Okay. So just to mention that everything that I say carries over to arbitrary densities, you simply replace discrete sums by integrals. And everything that I say, there's no problem, it carries over. So the discrete theory is just actually a particular case of the general theory where you use any probability measure. Okay? So why is this very interesting? Of course, it's interesting because it gives you access to the transport map, which is useful if you want to do interpolation. But what is much more important in my mind is that it gives you access to the values of this problem. So if you look at what is the value of this problem, it's defined some number. Okay? And if you take the power 1 over p of this number, it defines what is often called the Wasserstein distance, although Wasserstein has very little to do with it. The good name should be Monge-Kantorovich distance. And as its name suggests, this Wasserstein distance is a distance. So the value of this problem gives you access to a discrepancy between alpha and beta. So in particular, the value is zero if and only if alpha equal to beta. It satisfies the triangular inequality. Okay, you would say, okay, I know tons of distance. For instance, the L1 norm is good distance between probability. Why should I care about this optimal transport distance at all? You should care because it's really a geometrical distance. And from a mathematical perspective, how do you describe what it means to be geometrical? It means you should care about the translation of objects. Okay? And the good notion of topology that cares about translation of objects is what is called the weak topology, which means the weak star topology. For those who are probabilists, it's what is called the convergence in law. So if you view your density as a distribution of a random vector, the topology of the weak convergence is the topology of the convergence in law that everybody uses when you speak about, for instance, the central limit theorem. Many theorems in probability, they are really using this geometric notion of convergence. So in terms of math, what does it mean? Some measure, some sequence of measure alpha n converge in law or converge weakly to another one if and only if all possible linear integrals, so little aggregation of mass, converge. In terms of random variable, it means all possible expectations converge to the limit expectation. So it's really like an integrated or a weak notion of convergence. So what is a typical, a canonical example of weak convergence is if you imagine a point, so a Dirac, which converges, so the xi converges progressively to xn, then the Dirac mass converges in the weak sense. But it doesn't converge in a strong sense, in the sense of function, first because this is not a function, it's a Dirac. But if you think about the most simple way to compare two distributions, the most simple way is just the L1 norm. Okay? If you compute the L1 norm of the difference between two Diracs, so this Dirac minus this Dirac, if the two Diracs doesn't overlap, then the difference, the mass of the difference would be 2. So in terms of L1 convergence, a Dirac never converges to another one. Okay, the good notion of convergence when you look at object that moves is going to be the weak convergence. And guess what? The Wasserstein distance is a way to ensure this convergence. So in terms of mathematics, it means a distribution converges to another one if and only if they converge for the optimal transport. It's not the only distance that has this property, but it's one of the few that has this property. So it's very important for many applications. And I will explain, especially in high dimension for unsupervised learning, it's very important to be able to be very sensitive to misfits or to geometrical movements. Okay? So I guess this is really the main reason why we should care about using optimal transport for many problems in imaging and in machine learning. Okay? The notion of I want to use this rather weak convergence. All right, so now that I've explained a bit what is optimal transport distance, why it's important from a mathematical perspective, good question is how do you compute it? And the bad news is it's quite expensive. Except in some simple case, in general, it's cubic time. Okay? If you give me two distribution of points and you want to compute the distance, I have to solve a linear problem. And for this specific class of linear problem, optimal algorithms, they are simplex algorithms, and they have cubic complexity. So it's either good or bad. It depends whether n is small or not so small. So for n to the order of a few thousand, it's really, really efficient. So if your data set is below 1,000 points, still attend to my talk, but okay, what I would say after is not very relevant, at least if you just want to compute with zero error the optimal transport distance. Okay? There are some special cases for which you can use a faster algorithm. The one that is the best known is the optimal matching problem. It corresponds to the case where you have two distributions of the same number of points with equal weights. It's going to be empirical distribution of point clouds. In this case, you can show that the optimal transport of Kantorovich is equal to the optimal transport of Monge, meaning that you would only have deterministic movement of mass, no point will be split in half. It's a very remarkable result. In this case, it corresponds to a combinatorial optimization for which you have a little more efficient algorithm. The most well-known are the Hungarian algorithm, which is very famous, and also the auction algorithm, which are very, very clever and beautiful optimization method that works in cubic complexity. In practice, they are the most efficient option here. There is a trivial case. So if you're in 1D, actually, optimal transport is a bit boring because optimal transport is really like a flat geometry. There is nothing really interesting. If you take, for instance, the simple case where you have two-point cloud with the same number of points in 1D, for instance, the distribution of pixels in a gray scale images, then the optimal transport map is obtained by sorting the point from left to right and mapping the first blue point to the first red point and the second one to the second one and so on. So the complexity of optimal transport in 1D is n log n. And it's really, if you have instead of points, you have densities, it's going to be a distance between the cumulative, norm between the cumulative distribution. So it's really not very interesting. Okay? Another case that is worth mentioning is the case of Monge. In this case, you can have a more efficient algorithm because you can show that optimal transport can be recasted as a mean cost flow on the graph. So instead of looking for a displacement, you look for a vector field that would advect the mass. Not describe it, but the intuition is it's much cheaper. So it's basically quadratic complexity. Okay, it's nice to know. In 2D, optimal transport is actually related to partial differential equation and to geodesics, computation of geodesics. If you now introduce a time and you will do the transportation progressively in time between the initial density and the final density. This was proved by two mathematicians, Jean-David Benamou and Yann Brogner, who are one of the founding fathers of optimal transport. And this is a geodesic between Yann's density. So here, gray, black, sorry, means lot of mass. Okay. And Jean-David Benamou. So it's totally something that you should not do. I don't think optimal transport should be used to interpolate between two phases. You see, it gives a crazy distortion, but it's just for fun. Okay. Optimal transport is not something you want to use for image modification. It's really, an image is not a density. All right? But it's fun. Another case that was studied a lot by Quentin Merigo is a case where you want to map set of points toward the continuous density. This case is very closely related to what is called optimal quantization, k-means, and Lloyd algorithm. So I will not enter the details. But in this case, optimal transport boils down to computing Voronoi cells. So there is a very nice algorithm based on the computation of Voronoi cells that works well in low dimension. So once again, if you are in these settings, these are very efficient algorithms. But I think the key question is, what happens if you have a generic cost, not a Euclidean cost? What happens if you are in very high dimension? And more importantly than this, are you really interested in computing optimal transport with arbitrary accuracy? And I will argue that in high dimension, it's actually not what you want to do, because this could not work. So in many situations, what you care is to have a good approximation of optimal transport that would be more stable and faster to compute. And this is what I will explain now. So the goal now of my talk is really to insist on the idea that in practice, you never really want to compute optimal transport with high precision. Okay, and the technology that I will promote is a very simple idea that you can trace back to Schrödinger that was using this for modeling gas interaction, which is this idea of you have a linear problem that is very hard to optimize. You would make it simpler by penalizing it with a strictly convex penalty. So you would make the problem more curvy, more simple to solve. And in these settings, in some sense, the best from an algebraic point of view regularization is the entropy, the Shannon entropy. So I'm penalizing the optimal transport cost with actually the classical Shannon entropy. I just reweight here by the input mass. I don't really explain why, but it's very natural to use the entropy with respect to the input distribution of mass. Just a little trick that is really important to have good mathematical property. I write this in discrete, but everything can be done for arbitrary density. So epsilon is a temperature, and if epsilon goes to zero, temperature goes to zero, you approximate the optimal transport more and more efficiently. But of course, the algorithm would be slower and slower. So really the goal, and I will insist on this on high dimension, is to have an epsilon that maybe is not too small, to be very robust in high dimension and have algorithms that are very fast. Okay? And it's really something very similar to statistical physics. If epsilon is zero, the optimal transport between point clouds is just the optimal match. And you see as epsilon goes increases, you have more and more interaction, more and more stability. And as the large epsilon limits, and I will explain this later, everybody, all the particles interact with everybody. And then I will explain what this limit is, but it's related to other notion that is not at all optimal transport. But I will explain this. And in 1D, if you want to couple two densities, a very celebrated theorem of Yann Brunier says that Monge and Kantorovich are once again equal, and the optimal coupling is localized on a bijective map, an increasing map here. And you, if you introduce a little bit of temperature, what would happen if you would typically blur this? Instead of having a single bijection, you would have some kind of a blurry stochastic interaction. So the goal of epsilon is to introduce a smoothing or more interaction to make things faster to compute and more stable. It's kind of the intuition. Now I will describe the algorithm, and you would see the algorithm become almost trivial, much more simple than implementing a simplex. So anyone that has already tried once in his life to implement a simplex knows that it's really like painful. It's also very hard to parallelize. And entropy will decouple everything. Okay? So what do you do? If you look at this, this is a convex, strictly convex optimization problem. So the immediate reflex you should have when you view a problem is to look at the optimality condition, or to look at the dual problem, which is essentially the same. And if you use the math here, you introduce Lagrangian multiplier for the constraints. It's exactly what you do also when you have a minimum entropy method in probability. What you would find is the solution has a very nice expression in terms of a Gibbs kernel, in terms of a Gibbs distribution. So what is the Gibbs kernel associated to optimal transport? It's simply exponential minus the cost divided by epsilon. So it's a big, big matrix. So if you think about the classical case of Euclidean distance, this would simply be a Gaussian convolution kernel. Okay? But it's general, it's just some exponential kernel. And the theorem is like this, and it's very easy to prove, is that you are a solution, a Kantorovich solution to this problem. You are the optimal transport matrix with this little bit of regularization, if and only if you can be written in a factor way as the Gibbs kernel, multiplying the rows by some scalar ui and the column by some scalar vi. So in terms of matrix, it means that your optimal transport should be the Gibbs kernel, multiply on the left by a diagonal matrix and on the right by another diagonal matrix. You diagonally scale the rows and the column, which is something that is not specific to optimal transport. It's a problem very important in data science, actually, in statistics. You have an array of numbers, and you want to normalize them by normalizing the rows and the columns. And it's a natural question. Is it possible to always normalize an array of numbers? Here's the question is, can you normalize an array of numbers so that the sum of the rows and the sum of the columns stay the same? Okay. And the answer is yes, because it's simply an optimization problem that always have a solution. And not only it's yes, but it suggests a very natural algorithm. What you want is to find this U and this V such that the rows has a prescribed sum and the column has a prescribed sum. So you should have P times 1 equal A. If you rewrite this in terms of U and V, it has a very nice expression, which is this one. It's going to be you look for U and you look for V such that this non-linear equation holds. U, so this is dot multiplied, it's just the multiplication of each entry of a vector. So the vector U multiplied by the vector KV, so here it's matrix vector multiplication, should be equal to A. So here it's just a rewriting of the constraint in terms of U and V. And of course you have the same for the conservation of mass in the other direction, and you exchange the role of U and V. So the question, which is equivalent to solving this problem, can you find U and V that satisfy at the same time these two? And if you can find them, then you have solved the Schrödinger problem, because it's if and only if, because everything is convex. And it suggests a trivial algorithm. You just take this one, and you compute U by dividing A by this guy. If you do this, of course, then this equation will be satisfied. I'm just telling you that if you look at this constraint, it's very easy to satisfy. But the problem is if you do this, then you will typically violate, of course, the other constraints. But what is hard is to satisfy them both at the same time. So what you do is a very simple, like chicken and egg problem. You iterate in a fixed point manner between updating U and updating V. And usually if you do this, it never works. Okay, like iterative algorithms like this, they hardly work. But here, if you test, it works. And actually, it's proved, it has been proven by Simcorn in 64. In fact, this algorithm is very old. It's much older than Simcorn. It's even older than Kantorovich. It's a traditional algorithm to normalize the matrix by dividing the rows and the column iteratively. Here, I just explained to you that this very naive algorithm is actually an algorithm that solves approximately optimal transport. And it usually has the name of Simcorn because he's the first mathematician that proved its convergence with a very, very nice, actually, analysis. Right? So it's to me, it's the simplest algorithm you can find to approximate optimal transport. And it really works amazingly well if epsilon is not too small. First, it converges very fast if epsilon is large, so this you can do the math for this, but more important than this, this is an algorithm that is super easy to parallelize. Okay, so if in a machine learning setup, instead of having to compare just two inputs, you have to compute optimal transport between thousands or millions of inputs, here you can run everything in parallel because the only difficult task is the multiplication of a matrix times a vector. Okay, and of course, if you have several inputs, you would replace matrix vector multiplication by matrix matrix multiplication. You simply store all your data sets in a big matrix. And this is really what GPU are made for. So this algorithm is really a game changer if you map it on GPUs. Because this is what GPUs knows how to do very efficiently, like this matrix vector multiplication. So this is where you really gain a lot with respect to more traditional optimal transport model. So in practice, it's really what we aim for, is this like large-scale setup. And I will also explain that not only it's important for an algorithmic perspective, but now I will explain to you that it's also important in high dimension, because it introduces a lot of stability to have this epsilon. Okay? So before doing this, let me just sketch that there is many extensions of this ID and this optimal transport method. Much more than this that I will explain. There is quantity of optimization problems that are somehow related to this optimal transport problem. The iconic one, the simplest one, is the problem of Barry Center. Instead of just having two inputs that you want to couple, now you have several inputs. And you want to find in the middle of some density that minimize the sum of optimal transport distance. So if you have three inputs, you are just actually looking for three optimal transport couplings at the same time. So instead of just one, you want to optimize over three couplings. So it's a very natural extension. A nice remark is that optimal transport is actually a solution of a convex problem, but it also defines the convex function of its input. So the optimal transport distance is actually a convex function, which is remarkable. In general, the distance is not convex. So this problem is actually a convex optimization problem that was studied by Marshall Aguet and Guillaume Carli a few years ago. And in fact, you can do everything that I've said, so this idea of Schrödinger relaxation, you can apply it to the Barry Center, and then you will find a Simcorn algorithm for the Barry Center. It's very, very simple to do. We did this in a paper, and it works really well. Here is an example where you interpolate between shapes as if they were like distribution of clays inside the support. So as a disclaimer, I don't think it's a good method for interpolating shape. It's really like not at all integrating the notion of smoothness of a shape or like elastic deformation. But the good news is that it's very cheap, very simple to move. It's like a poor man's way to interpolate between shapes. This is another example that we worked on a lot with our previous PhD students, Lena Ishiza. It was a collaboration with François-Xavier Vallard. And then the natural question is, everything that I've said so far is for probability distribution. So I require the mass to be like unit mass. And in many situations, for instance, if you have shapes, they are not normalized. The area of the shape is not normalized. So typically, the input mass is not normalized. So they have different mass. What is the problem with optimal transport is you require exact conservation of mass. So this is an example of the interpolation along optimal transport. Geodesics that you obtain if you want to map this mixture of two Gaussian in blue to this mixture of two Gaussian in red. But I do a little trick. This mass here is a bit larger than this map here. So because of the conservation of mass, optimal transport cannot map this one to this one. So it will break this Gaussian in two and it will give this kind of ugly soliton that is forced to be mapped from here to the opposite side. So optimal transport is typical behavior in optimal transport. If you are not careful, it will lead to very, very irregular interpolation because of this lack of balance of mass. In contrast, what we do here is to simply, instead of asking for the first marginal for the sum of the rho to be exactly equal to alpha, we just penalize. We do like a smoother thing. We do like a soft constraint of mass conservation. And I will not enter the detail, but the natural way to penalize is using the Kullback labeled geometry. So if you do this, you actually preserve all the nice properties of optimal transport, like it defines a metric, a distance, it's a geodesic distance, it defines a weak convergence, and so on. So it's really natural to do this. And if you do this, you can have also a nice interpretation of the optimal transport, as what you do is both you advect the mass, but at the same time, you can remove mass, so you can kill a particle, or you can create mass. So it's kind of a hybridation between the optimal transport geometry, which is just like an horizontal geometry that only moves the mass, and the Kullback geometry or the Fischer geometry, which in the contrast is operating in the other direction. So where you can create, add a little bit of mass or remove a little bit of mass. So this introduces a relaxation parameter rho, and for typical application in machine learning, you would cross-validate the rho to see what is the best geometry. The best geometry, for sure, it's not optimal transport. For sure, it's not Kullback, it's something in between. So here, the interesting idea is to mix the two, and in practice, it's really what works the best. So I strongly advise you to test this. It's usually better than pure optimal transport. And guess what? Simcorn algorithm extends also very easily to this formulation. All right. So these are like an example of extension. There are tons of other examples where optimal transport can be used as a routine, I would say, to compare distribution, and you won't end up having an optimization problem to solve. Probably more complicated than this, but where you could also use Simcorn and so on. Okay. So now I will try to dive a bit more into this anthropic regularization as just a loss function you want to use typically in machine learning to estimate densities. And the first thing is the bad news is if you use it like this, it doesn't work. And what is the reason for this? The reason is because you add a little bit of entropy. It's not a distance anymore. In particular, the distance of alpha to itself is non-zero. It's weird, but because of the diffusion, because of the temperature, you have to do some effort to come back to yourself. So it's non-zero, so which means that if you do template matching, like non-parametric estimation, where you are free to choose any alpha, of course the solution should be alpha equal beta, the best possible match should be the input. And it's not the case, what you observe is a bias because of the entropy, where the optimal fitting in red, as you increase epsilon, will shrink towards the barycenter. So epsilon, if you increase it to a faster algorithm, the downside is you would introduce a shrinkage. So it's really bad, and in practice, it means that this would not work. Okay, so then we were thinking with Aude, how can we do to somehow change this, to correct for this bias? And we came up with a very simple trick, a hack, which is, let's remove the part that is problematic. Just remove one half of the distance or the cost from alpha to itself and one half of beta to itself. It looks very dumb, but at least what it does is that this guy is zero on the diagonal. When alpha equals beta, this guy vanishes.
But of course, since you have removed a positive number, this might become negative, so maybe it's actually worse. Maybe by trying to fix a problem, you actually create another problem that is even worse. So what we did is we tried it on the computer, and we tested it on many instances, and it was always positive. So I was wondering, hey, it looks weird, it looks like there is a theorem behind it, but when you look at this, I was surprised. So we worked for at least 1 year and a half until we really understood what was happening, which is what I'm going to present. The first thing we did, which is actually very simple but very insightful, is to see at what happened in the small and in the large epsilon limits. So in the small epsilon limits, it's not so surprising that this guy and this guy will cancel out, because this would converge to the optimal transport between alpha and is zero. And this, we have studied this with Guillaume Carlier and collaborator, this would converge to the optimal transport, because you don't regularize. So the small epsilon limit is just optimal transport. But what is more interesting is the large epsilon limit becomes the Euclidean distance, Euclidean norm, that is very famous. That they are called, usually in the statistic literature, maximum mean discrepancies. In the image processing or shape, they are often called kernel method. And they actually correspond in functional analysis to Sobolev spaces. So it's something that is very, really, really well studied. It is much simpler actually than optimal transport. What is it? And I will define this very briefly, but there is like books on the subject. And the guy that works the most on this is Arthur Gretton. The idea is simply you take your distribution, alpha and beta, you compute the difference, because you want to compute the norm, they call it psi. And then you compute the double interaction of psi with itself. You pick a kernel, and you integrate twice this kernel against yourself. So if you have discrete points, it means you do a double sum. So here it's a double integral, but if it's points, it's going to be a double sum of the kernel value between all the pairs of points. It's like everybody will interact with everybody. It's why I was saying that Schrödinger is introducing this idea of making people speak to each other. In the large epsilon limit, you just double integral your kernel. And here, if you do syncorn, the kernel you would use looks very weird. It's minus the distance to the power p. You say, okay, it looks weird, there is a minus. How this could be positive? In fact, it's positive in some case, because there is a minus, but you have to remember that here, you're computing something that is a difference of two measures. So in particular, it has a zero mean. So if you double integrate something of zero mean against minus the Euclidean distance, for instance, then it's positive. And actually has a name, this guy. It's named the energy distance. Although it's a norm, I don't know why they call this energy distance. We call it the energy norm. So for p between 0 and 2, it's not so hard to see that this guy is a norm. And it actually has a name in analysis. It's called a Sobolev norm. It's a Sobolev norm of negative index. Okay. So what you recover in the large epsilon limit for the synchron algorithm, or the synchron divergence, so with the extra correcting term, is a simple Hilbertian norm between the measures. It's very natural. So you see that this technology of synchron divergence can be seen as a way to interpolate between two very different class of distance. One that would be very flat, which is just a Hilbertian distance. Something that is very flat. If you use it to interpolate, you would just do like classical mixture models. But of course, if epsilon goes to zero, you become very non-flat, like a geodesic space of optimal transport. And then the interpolation becomes much more interesting. But of course, it's much more complicated. Okay, so I think it's quite insightful. But still, it was lacking this property of being positive. And in fact, we proved it very recently with Jean Feldi and collaborators that it's true, it's positive. But of course, it's not always positive. You need some hypothesis. And the key hypothesis, that actually is very natural when you look at synchron, is that the Gibbs kernel should be positive semi-definite. So if you think, for instance, of the Euclidean distance here, if p is between 0 and 2, then it's a kernel that would be positive, and then it would work. But if you use p larger than 2, like p equal 4, for instance, I don't know why you would do this, but okay, it's not guaranteed. And in practice, you can find examples where it's not positive. But fortunately, for small p, which is the settings we use in practice, it's going to be a positive kernel. And this guy, the synchron divergence, is going to be positive. And thus, going to be something that you can use as a discrepancy. So it's positive, but it's zero if and only if alpha equals beta. And it's something that metrizes the weak convergence, meaning that we still have this nice geometric property of if alpha geometrically converges to beta, then this synchron divergence will converge to zero. So it's validate the idea that you can use it. If you do this for non-parametric fitting, well, you obtain what you guess you should obtain is that the optimal match is just the red point equals the blue point, which is alpha equals beta, and the cost is zero. An additional bonus, and it explains, it doesn't really give you the proof, but it explains why there is something happening, is that actually the optimal transport cost, if you want, here the sine cone cost, is convex of alpha and it's convex of beta. Okay, something that is not too hard to show. But actually, if you look it along the diagonal, so if you put alpha equal beta, it becomes concave. So it's a function that is convex on the alpha axis, convex on the beta axis, but concave on the diagonal. So it's a bit weird. Like the function of minus x times y. It's convex along x, convex along y, but concave along the diagonal. So and if you put a minus, then it's convex. So this guy is convex, this guy is convex, this guy is convex. So in fact, this guy is actually a convex function. It's really nice, so it means you can study by center. So everything you want to do when you use convex optimization, you can use with the normalized cost. Okay, so it's really a good news for us. The other good news, which was, I guess, to be expected, is what happened in high dimension. Okay, and it's not really a way to say that this could work for machine learning problem, but I think it's a sanity check that you could do to start with, is in practice in machine learning, you never really have access to alpha and beta. You rather have access to discrete samples. And the first question is, when you discretize your problem, does it converge? And if it converges, at what speed? The fact that it converges, it's obvious, it's just the law of large number, that the distance they will converge. But the question is, if you, instead of using of computing the true optimal transport distance, you compute the optimal transport between discrete samples, at what speed would it converge to zero? And the bad news is, it converges very, very slowly. In fact, you pay the curse of dimensionality. You have exponential dependency on the dimension. Okay, and the convergence rate is 1 over n to the power 1 over n. So if d is larger than 5, and in typical machine learning, you are at least in dimension 10 or 100, it's doomed to fail. If you have a generic density, like on a cube, you can never estimate it, the optimal transport using discrete sample. It's just too costly. Yeah. If optimal transport works, it's because of some other reason. But from a discrete point of view, it will be a failure. On very sharp contrast, if you do the same sanity check with Euclidean norms, basically because of the central limit theorem, you would become, like in Monte Carlo method, you would become independent of the dimension. So maybe it will not work for some other reason, but at least you can estimate the distance. And you can estimate this at a rate that is 1 over square root of n, which is the usual rate to estimate Euclidean quantities. Okay? And now the question is, what happened with this syncorn? Since it's interpolating between the two, the guess is that it should interpolate between these two rates, and it's what we proved recently with all Francis Back and Marco Pichuri, is that the rates, as soon as epsilon is strictly positive, at least in Euclidean space, this is true for Euclidean optimal transport, the rate between one of becomes 1 over square root of n. But of course, there is no free lunch, because you know when epsilon goes to 0, this should blow. So the rate becomes 1 over square root of n, but the constant explodes with epsilon, like epsilon to the power minus d divided by 2. So there is no free lunch. If you want to approximate optimal transport, you will need to pay a price that will blow with epsilon. So if you even try to be clever and say, let's choose epsilon as a function of n, and you match the error you make with the one you make when you approximate with syncorn, you would recover a rate that is this one. So you would typically not gain. Okay, so syncorn is not a way to approximate optimal transport more efficiently. It's just a way to define a new set of discrepancy that you can estimate more efficiently. So the goal is to be able to show, maybe later, for now we don't have any theory for this, that you could use a larger epsilon, so you could beneficiate for a better sample complexity than optimal transport, but at the same time benefit from the geometry of optimal transport, which would help to have better things if density or like shifty, or if you have some translation to estimate, where optimal transport is clearly much better than kernel methods. Okay? So for now, unfortunately, we don't have any theory. So I want to conclude briefly on the idea of using this for GANs. I have a few minutes left. So unfortunately, I think this would be quite deceiving because I want to convey the idea that GAN is too complicated for us, at least for mathematicians. But there is a very nice opportunity to understand this. So the general idea is to do density fittings, as I've already said. Okay. One classical approach, I would say, in statistics is to say, okay, the model I have, the alpha theta I want to use as templates, they have a density with respect to a fixed distribution, like the Lebesgue one, for example, but it doesn't really matter which one you use. Then you set up a maximum likelihood estimator, minimize the sum of minus the log of the density. And the rationale for this is you make the assumption that samples are independent. Okay, so minus the log would make this into the product into a sum. So this works great for many applications. The simplest case is the Gaussian case where you have the closed form expression. But what people want to do now is to do estimation in very high dimension, where typically this hypothesis will break. The hypothesis that you can have a fixed reference measure that will work for all your models is not possible in very, very high dimension. And the typical scenario where this breaks is the so-called generative model scenario, where you say, instead of trying to prescribe a density, high dimension is very hard, I will prescribe an algorithm to draw random sample. And what is this algorithm? The algorithm is very simple. Is you first draw a point at random in low dimension, square for instance, and then you map this point to some function, parametric function, j theta. And in practice, it would be probably a deep net, because it's something that models well complicated images. So you just push forward, in terms of distribution, a low dimensional distribution in very high dimension. So what would happen is this, the support of this distribution would be very singular, distributed along some sum of hypersurface in very high dimension. So in practice, it would mean that here you would have log of zero. So what does it mean? It means that MLE is not fine, because the support of this guy will change if theta change. So there's no way you can come up with a dx that would be working for everybody. So in this scenario, it's so singular in high dimension that you cannot estimate the maximum likelihood. You need to come up with like regularization method, and you typically need to introduce kernels and so on. So what you need actually to do is to use the loss function that is not the Kullback loss function that you use in MLE, but that is a function that is regular with respect to the weak convergence. And of course, here what I want to say, maybe IDs from optimal transport is what you are looking for. So for instance, you could try to do density fitting with this normalized synchron divergence, which of course contain as particular case the Wasserstein estimators and the MMD estimator as two extreme cases. Okay. So no mathematics, it's just, okay, you can use it, and it makes sense from an optimization perspective, because everything is continuous here. The typical scenario, and I'm not a specialist in deep learning, but the typical scenario where this makes sense in practice is where you would use deep learning, deep network, not in the traditional way that people use for discrimination, for supervised learning, but rather in the opposite way, where you would start by a low-dimensional score vector, and then you would map it until you get an image by basically playing the layer backwards. So the idea of generative deep network is that the generative net has kind of the opposite or the adjoint geometry as the discriminative net. So what you would do is you would progressively enlarge the dimension of your data until you get an image. And this simple idea works amazingly well in practice. Nobody really understood why, but it's really something that can model very complicated natural images. You can do this with simple little digits. It's very boring. In this case, you can even take random points in 2D. Well, of course, if you have more complicated images, you need to have a latent space, so the space for the Z to be more high dimensional, like dimension 100. Okay, so I will skip how you do this in practice. It's very complicated. You need to use some kind of stochastic gradient, but there is no theory for this because nothing is really like an integral, so it's very complicated. You can just use it. Seems to work. The architecture of the net is complicated, of course. And it's even more complicated because you typically have then to compute the optimal transport distance using SYNCHRON. So it's typical, I would say, computational diagram that you would have, where you have your deep nets, your input data, and the function that would compare your input data with your deep nets. Okay, I don't want to go into the details, but it's basically to show that the function, the architecture that defines your loss function is complicated. Same thing, I don't have a lot of time, but what do you do when you have a complicated function to minimize? So I guess probably many of you already know this, but it's quite interesting. What you would do is, how do you compute the gradient of a complicated function? So if you think you have some kind of complicated function that runs in k operation, okay, for instance, the one I've shown before, it runs in k operation, what is the complexity of computing the gradient of your function? That now is a map from Rn to Rn. Okay, so probably you know the answer, but what is the complexity of computing gradients? It's a fundamental question for numerical analysis in some sense. The naive answer would be, okay, you could try using finite differences, of course, or you could try using the classical chain rule. If you do this, you end up having an algorithm that scales linearly with the dimensions. It's very bad. If you're in high dimension, of course, you cannot use finite difference. Everybody knows this. What is the answer to this problem? Actually, definitive answer, it's you should use a backward automatic differentiation, what is called reversed mode. So in this case, you would have the complexity of computing the gradient that would be exactly the same as the complexity of computing the function. So it's typically what everybody knows in deep learning, that you should use backpropagation, which is a specific case of this term. So of course you can use this for arbitrary architecture like the one we've done for SYNCHRON, but for basically any loss function. So in practice, it's what people would do. These are simple examples we did in my team, nothing very spectacular. In fact, there is many, many other methods that can be used to train GANs, many heuristics to define loss functions that are typically not, for instance, based on optimal transport. It's not clear what is the best. Some claim one is better than the other, but every week there is a new paper that, that basically improve. What works well is just using a larger network, typically. So I will not really give you any insight of what is the best loss function to give the best GANs results. Of course, in practice, one hidden question in my talk is what is the metric you should use to compare images? And of course, for image, you should not use the L2 norm because it's a total failure. Everybody also knows this in image processing. So what you should do when you want to do high quality generation of images is also learn the metric, which would lead you to exactly the same class of architecture or very similar architecture that people do in so-called GANs. So it was introduced by Ian Goodfellow few years ago, where you learn another network to discriminate your images. So here, discriminating your images would mean finding the good metric to discriminate the image. So in practice, what you have to do is something even more complicated than what I've said before, where you also want to learn a second network in competition to the first one. Okay, so for those who know GAN, it's really like typical of what they also do in practice. You need to train two networks in tandem. Okay? So it raises a lot of questions. What is the influence of epsilon? How can you even say that one GAN is better than another one? Maybe you could say, okay, maybe the best GAN is the one that minimizes the Wasserstein error, but in high dimension, it's not possible to compute. And in practice, what people want is high quality images, which has nothing to do with high quality optimal transport distance. So it's really like it's a very touchy problem that nobody really knows how to even frame what is the best GAN. I don't think anybody knows. For sure, having better image is something that you could do, but it's not related to having the best GAN. So it's an open problem. These are just for fun, but it's not my team. It's a result that was obtained at NVIDIA to interpolate between images. The first thing people do with GANs to check what it gives is to take two points in the latent space and draw some kind of a straight line, which would be mapped in some sort of curve on the space of images. So this was done by people at NVIDIA, so you can find the two videos online. And it really explained why it's so complicated, because it introduced some kind of interpolation that is fairly complicated. I would say that if 3 years ago people have said that you could get this kind of interpolation quality between images, nobody would have believed it. So I think it's a huge breakthrough. But at the same time, what you obtain here is probably very far from a good statistical model, because GANs usually they do like a poor job at really fitting the set of images, but they do a very good job at interpolating between images, which is a very different problem than a statistical problem. So it's really something that nobody can understand now, but raises a lot of challenges for statisticians. And with this, I will conclude my talk. So just to say that there is a really like a stream of a lot of previous work of great mathematicians, including a lot of Nobel Prize and field medalists. So Villani got the field medal in part for his work on optimal transport. This summer, Alessio Figali, who is a student of Cedric Villani, won also the field medals for theorems on the regularity of optimal transport, which people care about in math, but here, I would say it's not so relevant. So there's a lot of strong mathematicians, but now the question is, can you apply it in high dimension? The answer is no. Of course you cannot, because it's too complicated, it's statistically not relevant. But can you take some ideas from this great mathematician and use them to solve open problem in machine learning? I hope so, and I think it's quite exciting. Okay, thanks a lot for your attention.
We have time for questions. Consensus for the apéro, yeah. Yes?
Okay. This is my own question. About the image, for instance, you mentioned the L2 loss is not so sensitive. What about this speech, for instance, for two conditions with the Laborel speech or space program?
So I'm not a specialist, but I think that Cedric Fevot and collaborator they worked a bit on using optimal transport on spectrograms, and then they use kind of a harmonic distance where you penalize differently depending on the harmonics. And they seem to give good results, but I'm not an expert. But in this case, at least I know one previous work that uses optimal transport for interpolating, for instance, between spectrogram or comparison of spectrogram. If it's relevant for speech, I don't know. But at least for music, like when you have a lot of harmonics, it seems like there is a geometry of sound that could be used. Like the fact that you have like this geometry of sound and where it would be natural to use optimal. If you want, I can send you the reference. If you just Google a Cedric Favot and optimal transport, yes, you would find it.
As usual, I'm not quite formulating it properly, but I know what to. I want to ask, when you talked about, I want to say those green Danish pastries, these shapes on the that we can see now, you talked about the algorithm that's generated them, or the interpolated them, as not having any physical constraints. So you said that it wasn't a good algorithm. But I wonder, do you know that, or can you discard the possibility that it's actually learned the physical constraints for itself, and that's what it's using internally?
So are you speaking about these very simple things, or the GANs interpolation?
Yeah. I'm talking about the simple ones.
So for the simple one, I think we understand fairly well what happened, and it's very disappointing, because what happened in optimal transport is, if you think about, instead of having like this continuous distribution, but just set of points, like this guy, what would be the interpolation? It's very disappointing. It's just this straight point will move in straight line. So the interpolation you obtain is just movement in straight line. Of course, it's not so trivial, because you don't know beforehand what would be the straight line. So there is, of course, a non-trivial thing. If you give me two shapes, I need to compute these tons of straight line everywhere. But once these straight lines are computed, then the interpolation is really like everybody's independent of each other. So they are not independent, because the distribution of straight line, there is some dependency. But after you have resolved this, what you want to map with them, like each point lives its life independently and move in a straight direction. So I think this is what I would call a non-physical interpolation, at least if you care about the shapes as a global. So it's really an interpolation that is very natural in many physical cases, like for fluid dynamics, it's a way to integrate projection on divergence free constraint. Like there are many physical problems where natural optimal transport plays a role. But for shape interpolation, I would say no. I mean, at least you should introduce some knowledge about what it means to be a shape. And this makes the problem much, much harder, because then everything breaks. Like if you want to introduce some notion of regularity, like points that are close, they should move to a close by direction, it makes things intractable. So what people would do is like non-convex solver, and then you could have methods. But the theory of shape and the interpolation between shape is enormously more complicated than just optimal transport. And yeah, I guess modeling shape is very complicated. So it's unfortunate, but I would say if you care about shape, you should go to more complicated things than just this. This is what I mean by non-physical. There are physical models, though, that you could model with optimal transport, like gas, particle interaction, even in quantum physics. It's a much higher dimension, but you have also optimal transport methods to solve quantum physics. But these are quite different from shapes.
I've got one more totally different question. When you first set out describing this, when one talks about optimal transport, one thinks of, okay, there's a right way to do this. But throughout the talk,
yep.
And then you were quite explicitly talking about hacks at some point. And I'm wondering, generally speaking, and I realize it's just subjective, how much of this is sort of dictated by solid underlying theory? How much of it needs some sort of knowledge of hacks just to get it going?
It's a very good question. So I think it's my way of describing things. It's also the way I've worked in research, by trying many ideas and then keeping the one that works. But what we observe, usually it's after, so it's very simple to redo the history backward. But what happens is everything then gets confirmed by very strong theoretical things. And the most striking example is this, there's many ways where this happened. For example, for the entropy, so you could say it's a hack, but it's not a hack. It's very fundamental. And I discovered after that it's what used a lot in physics, and there was very deep reason why the entropy is the only functional that you can use to make things work. So if you use, because of course you could say, oh, let's use another entropy functional, let's use, instead of Shannon, let's use like Salis entropy or whatever, but then everything breaks, like everything that I've explained would break for very deep reason. So the first step, of course, is a hack, but at the end, no, nothing is a hack, it's really confirmed by Strong Theory. And the other thing that is, I think, a very good example is this unbalanced transport, which looks like a hack where you just penalize it. And since I just have like 2 minutes to explain this, I need to explain like this way to give to you the formula and say it looks like a hack. But in fact, there is a very deep thing that says that this is the only way to penalize so everything stays like a very nice stream of theory. There is a single geometry on the space of positive measure that extends the geometry on probability measure. And we are, there are three teams that work exactly at the same time, so I think we published the paper on archive like 2 weeks, at 2 weeks interval, that come up with the same idea. And there is no randomness. We came up with the same idea because it was the only way to introduce optimal transport on the cone of positive measure. And we are very happy because then everything matched together, like you can use the same algorithm with a very nice optimization formula, but really, The thing that I cannot explain here, it will require more time, is to say what geometry defines, what is a geodesic in this space, and so on. So I think at the end of the day, maybe if initially we started by hack, at the end, what I love is when everything gets confirmed by strong mathematical claims that makes it not anymore a hack. Okay, so I cannot really explain in details, but I really do care about at the end having something that is not just a hack. Although it's good to, at first, understand this as a hack because it's what we matter most is that it should work in practice. But if it works in practice, it's often because the math match at the end. I guess. Yeah.
So if you take the Wasserstein GAN, so you would directly minimize the standard balance one. And is there an algorithmic version? So if you minimize the Wasserstein distance, you get this optimization of the discriminator under Lipschitz. And if you take your unbalanced version, where you penalize more smoothly the marginals?
Yeah, so actually you can do the... Okay, once again, I cannot really explain in detail, we need a blackboard, but going to unbalanced, if you go to the dual, it's a way to relax the dual. So actually, what you do when you... because in Wasserstein, they don't do Wasserstein, but at the end, they replace everything by deep network, so then you are very far from Wasserstein. The fact that you restrict the set of dual potential by something different, is a way in the primal to also relax, make it unbalanced. So, and I think it's important, it's why GANs also works well, it's because at the end you are very relaxed about what you match. So when you do Wasserstein GAN, at the end, if you look, it's not convex, but if you were able to come back to the loss you obtain, it's not anymore a loss. It can be zero and alpha doesn't equal to beta, because you restrict too much the set of dual potential. So really, you have to be careful when you play on this dual potential. It's similarly to doing something on the primal to relax the primal. So for some cases, we know what we do. Like for this very specific way, I can give you the dual and you would see it's not at all like what you do in Wasserstein GAN. But if you do something too brutal, you even lose the fact that it's a metric. So you can do either as something good that you relax and it's good, but also something bad because then you cannot say anymore because you are not a metric, so you cannot say that if you minimize the min-max cost, you would not find alpha equal beta, so you would not actually do density. So yeah. So in the convex case, fortunately, you can do everything, so it's rather easy. But with Wasserstein GAN, okay, it's much harder because nothing is convex. But in fact, everything is connected because if you write the dual problem, you would of what I wrote, you would also see what happened on the dual potential. So the simple thing that people do. So this is what I propose is like a sophisticated way to do this. But the historical way to deal with unbalanced is to go to the dual, then you see that you have this dual potential, this discriminator, and you simply clip them so that they stay between minus one and one, and then you can do unbalanced. So a way to do unbalanced is just to clip the potential. Because the problem with unbalanced is the potential, they will go to plus infinity, so they will explode. But if you replace the potential by deep net, okay, you don't really know what you're going to do.
And speaking about hacks, when you subtract the one half of the Wasserstein, when you subtract the one half of the Wasserstein distance between alpha and alpha, what was the reason behind.
So in fact, so there's no real reason, but the key motivation. So as usual, when you do you prepare a talk, you like reverse history, you make this. Something that streamlined very well. But what happened is I didn't start from this. I start from this theorem. I wanted to guess what happened. I wanted to have a limit. And to have this limit, you immediately see you need to subtract these two guys. Because these two guys are what happened in this guy when you... Here you have a square. If you expand the square, you would have three terms. You would have minus twice this plus this plus this. Minus twice this plus this plus this. So, okay, if you work backward and you end up... So of course it's also a hack, but at least you understand where it comes from. So I start from this, I say, okay, you need to subtract the diagonal term of the MMD, because otherwise they will blow. I mean, you will never have this limit if you don't have these guys. So I fix them. Then it was not so clear from this, okay, but it's not so hard. And but the true hard part is to show positivity. So of course I could do everything backward and present first the theorem, but the truth is I started by this, and then... But maybe there is another way. I mean, I'm not sure it's the best way to do this, but at least if you want to do this limit, it looks natural.
So I think it's time we thank the speaker again, and then I'll make two announcements. So the first announcement is that, as you know, this is not the end of it, because there will be a crash course tomorrow morning at 8:30 in 4 or 5.